Good morning again. The good book says we must lay, we must not lay hands on no man suddenly. But of course, it happens. Thank you very, very much, Professor Huss, for sharing with us this morning. Very insightful presentation. And I think your presentation has done much to further elaborate the partnerships and the synergism between the management of diabetes and oral health. Now, the task today for me is to introduce Mr. Michael Salinero. Actually, Michael comes from the Wound Center in Miami, Florida. Having grown up in a family of healthcare providers, his dad a doctor and mom a nurse, and he himself adventured into the path of becoming one a healthcare professional, following in the footsteps of his mom. He currently works as the as an assistant manager at the Wound Center in Miami, Florida, and has tremendous experience in that department. I, without any further ado, would just like to invite Michael to come to the podium and to share with us his experiences in dealing with wound in the diabetic patient, wound management in the diabetic patient.
Thank you for having me here at this conference. Today, I'm going to be talking about diabetic foot ulcers, the prevention, risks, and treatment. As the moderator said, I am the assistant manager for a wound center at South Miami Hospital. We're a hospital-based outpatient wound center, and we take care of patients with a number of different wounds. Diabetic foot ulcers comprising of about 25 to 30% of the total patients that we see through our wound centers. A diabetic foot ulcer is a wound on the foot caused by a combination of different factors that are common in diabetics. Peripheral neuropathy being number one, peripheral artery disease, and diabetic foot deformities and neuroarthropies put patients at particular risk for developing diabetic foot ulcers. What you should know and the importance of treating and prompt treatment of diabetic foot ulcers is that one in four diabetics will develop a diabetic foot ulcer in the course of their lifetime. Of these diabetics who will have an ulcer, 15% of them will end in amputation. And the great majority of amputations on diabetics are as a result of an ulceration to the foot. Also, after amputation, the chance of contralateral amputation is greater than 50% over 5 years. And diabetics with a history of foot ulcers have a 47% higher mortality rate than diabetics who have not had ulceration. So it's very important to treat. These patients are at very high risk. The patient population who is at risk outside of being diabetic are patients who have diabetic neuropathy. Diabetic neuropathy can set place in as little as 5 years of being diabetic, type 1 or type 2. Also having peripheral artery disease, not just the macrovasculature, the large vessels, but also the very small vessels in the distal foot. Having foot deformities as well, diabetic neuropathy leads to neuroarthropy or changes in the foot that leads them to be more likely to develop ulceration. Having a previous history of ulceration also puts the patient at much higher risk of having a new ulcer. Previous amputations, typically the contralateral limb, is at much higher risk for developing an ulcer as well. Smokers also are more prevalent in developing diabetic foot ulcers, and poor glycemic control. As the speaker before alluded to, poor hemoglobin control can result in peripheral vascular disease, as well as developing diabetic neuropathy. So patients at risk would be those with foot deformities. One of the more common foot deformities of patients with diabetes is Charcot foot. There are a number of different neuroarthropies that are caused by diabetes, but Charcot is quite common, and it leads to increased pressure areas on the plantar surface of the foot, a fallout of the arch, which leads to ulceration not only of the plantar surface, but also of the dorsum of the foot. Patients with bunions as well will have the presentation of the first metatarsal head as opposed to the toes. They're at much higher risk of developing ulceration. Special shoes would be recommended for these patients, as improperly fitted shoes is usually the cause of the beginning ulceration of a patient with a foot deformity. Patients with hammer toes as well, instead of presenting the distal portion of the toe, will be presenting the knuckles, and improperly fitted shoes will cause increased pressure and the development of an ulcer on the toes. Toe ulcers specifically, the development of the ulcer has a high rate of complication due to the bony surfaces and tendons being so close to the superficial or the skin. Diabetic foot ulcers are more prevalent in the elderly patients, so as we grow older, we develop a higher risk of developing a diabetic ulcer, but it affects males and females equally. Prevention. Prevention is key in developing the ulcer, as they have so many complications and such high risk. So foot education and surveillance can reduce the incidence of serious foot ulcers, or can lead to them to be treated earlier before they become complicated. This includes typically daily foot inspections, the use of custom-made insoles, shoes or devices for patients with foot deformities, and a history of ulceration. So those patients with Charcot foot would be placed in a custom-made shoe that's wide and able to accommodate the foot. Hemoglobin A1C of less than 7% keeps the patient at reduced risk of developing peripheral artery disease and diabetic neuropathy. Although there's no concrete evidence that having a hemoglobin A1C of less than 7 accelerates wound healing, it does prevent complications that would lead to the formation of a diabetic foot ulcer. Annual foot inspections by a trained healthcare professional are also key to the prevention of foot ulceration. Identification of a foot deformity in its early stages would allow for a patient to be placed in an orthotic or a custom-made shoe and prevent a malfitting shoe from developing an ulcer on the foot. Here's an example of custom-made insole and also diabetic shoes. They tend to be wider. Some have Velcro strapping so that they're easier to be placed. These shoes are wider to accommodate the different sizes of foot from as a result of diabetic neuroarthropy or changes in the diabetic's foot. Elements of a foot inspection: it's important to use a mirror to inspect the plantar surface of the foot. Plantar ulcer is one of the more common areas to develop a diabetic foot ulcer. Also, paying careful attention to the areas in between the toes and the web spaces, they can hide ulcers that would not be detected without looking in between the toes. Also, checking for changes in the skin, calluses, blisters, cracks, rashes, or other small ulcerations would put the patient at much higher risk. Calluses in particular create increased pressure to the bottom of the foot and may be concealing ulcers or seroma formations, which can later turn into abscesses and develop into a diabetic foot ulcer. Inspection of the nails, in particular thick and ingrown corners, also keeping the length of the nails short. Longer nails can traumatize the contralateral limb, developing an ulcer, as well as ingrown toenails and thickened nails have a propensity to develop ulcerations along the nail bed and along the surfaces of the toe. Also, inspecting socks, it's important to tell your patients to wear White Sox detect any type of blood or discharge that would indicate that there is an ulceration. And this would be a very early sign. So a patient could have been walking on his sneakers all day, and when he removes his shoe and sock, if blood is noted, that would be the first indication that an ulceration is beginning. Also examining the shoes for tears in the lining, abnormal wear and hard surfaces on the inside. So literally running your hand along the inside of the shoe. Patients with diabetic neuropathy would not be able to feel any prominence inside the shoe, and these could lead to ulceration not only on the plantar surface but on the dorsum of the foot as well. Here are some abnormal findings. The picture on your left would be the development of an ulcer inside the web space of the foot. You can also see that the skin is macerated, and that's quite common on the web spaces of the foot. The toes are particularly susceptible to peripheral artery disease because they're so distant from the heart. Any blockages would most affect the toes and the most distal portions of our body. On the right is an example of a plantar surface callus. These calluses need to be removed in order to prevent excess pressure on the bottom of the foot. These calluses are formed due to diabetic neuropathy and an increase in friction. Also, poorly fitted shoes can lead to callus formation. Here would be a bloody sock after being removed by a patient who walked around in it too long. Being able to detect an ulcer at this early stage is really key in getting the ulcer healed. Goals for prevention would be for the patient not to form ulcers at all, prevent or worsening complications of present ulcers. So if a patient currently has an ulcer, it's important to prevent ulcers happening on the contralateral leg, as well as worsening of the diabetic foot ulcer, and prevention of recurrence of diabetic foot ulcers. Once a patient has had a history of ulcers, their likelihood of developing another one is much higher. Treatments is what I specialize in. This is what I do on a daily basis in our wound center. The key component to treating a diabetic foot ulcer is beginning with a comprehensive patient history. Factors in a patient's history that would affect wound healing are poor glycemic control, and although, as I alluded to before, there's no concrete evidence that having a lower hemoglobin A1C accelerates wound healing, anecdotally, we do note that patients who have better glycemic control tend to be more compliant and have better outcomes when it pertains to diabetic foot ulcers. Patients who have end-stage renal disease are also at much higher risk for developing ulceration. They also develop neuropathy as well, and end-stage renal disease is quite prevalent in the diabetic population. Having pulmonary disease as well can predispose patients to having or getting a diabetic foot ulcer. Patients who have pulmonary disease, especially those who require long-term steroids, have a decrease in wound healing rates and an increase in complications, especially infections. Patients with cardiovascular disease, specifically patients who have a history of heart attack, stroke, and valvular heart disease, are at much higher risk and have much slower healing rates. Autoimmune diseases such as lupus and rheumatoid arthritis can also affect the rate at which a patient would heal a diabetic ulceration, and these patients also run into their own set of ulcers that would be its own lecture in and of itself. Patients who smoke as well have a much slower healing rate. Smoking cessation is key to healing diabetic foot ulcers. The smoking tobacco in particular causes a narrowing of the arteries, and especially blockages in the macrovessels or the much larger blood vessels like the superficial femoral artery and iliac artery disease. Lab screenings that we would use to tell us whether the wound has a high propensity to heal or not would be a CBC. Patients who have low hemoglobins or anemic are at risk for stalling or stagnant wounds that don't progress due to the lack of oxygen that would get to the wound bed. BUN and creatinine levels are very important, as well as hemoglobin A1C, as I talked about before. Lipid profile as well. And if osteomyelitis is suspected, an erythrocyte sedimentation rate, or ESR, and a C-reactive protein may be considered to help rule out if a patient has developed osteomyelitis or a bone infection as a result of the diabetic foot ulcer. A comprehensive nutritional evaluation is also important. Having optimized nutrition will optimize wound healing. So things to be considered in this evaluation would be height and weight, BMI, unintentional changes in weight, patients who've had a history of diarrhea or constipation, as well as those who have an increase in alcohol intake. Patients who have feeding problems or who are missing their teeth as well are at risk for malnutrition. Patients as well who receive two feedings or on total parenteral nutrition, and those patients who have limited access to foods will be at high risk for malnutrition. Our bodies require proteins and different nutrients in order to heal wounds, so lacking of these nutrients would cause delays in wound healing. Other lab values that we could consider would be albumin and prealbumin. Albumin levels has long been considered the gold standard for determining a patient's long-standing nutritional status, especially as it pertains to their protein intake. These levels may be falsely low in patients who have kidney disease. A more accurate indicator of recent nutritional status is a prealbumin. Prealbumin has a much shorter half-life than albumin and would be more important in evaluating their recent nutritional status, especially if we have instituted change in the patient or asked them to increase their protein intake. This would be a good level. The half-life of prealbumin is about 2 weeks, so we would expect to see changes in prealbumin levels within 2 to 3 weeks after making dietary changes. The higher the albumin levels and prealbumin levels, the higher the likelihood of a patient to accelerate their wound healing. A neurological assessment is very important as part of assessment of the patient with the diabetic foot ulcer. There are several techniques that can be used to diagnose neuropathy. Two of the most common techniques are the Sims-Weinstein test, which is performed by using a 10-gram monofilament. With the patient's eyes closed, the monofilament would be pressed on areas of the plantar surface of the foot until the monofilament is slightly bent. If the pressure is not noted in at least 4 out of the 10 predefined areas in the Sims-Weinstein test, then the patient is positive for neuropathy. A tuning fork can be used as well to test for neuropathy. The tuning fork would be struck against the hard surface and then it would be placed against the malleolus, and the patient would report whether they feel the vibration or not. Here's an example of both. The Sims-Weinstein test is more common than the tuning fork and can be a very good indicator as to how severe the patient's neuropathy is. Performing a vascular assessment is also very important. An ankle brachial index is what we use in our wound center, and it can be performed using a handheld Doppler probe and a blood pressure cuff. The blood pressure cuff would be placed around the ankle and inflated. As the pressure drops, you would wait to hear the return of the pulse on the Doppler, and then this reading would be divided by the patient's brachial artery pressure, and that would give us a reading. Typically 0.8 to 1 would be 1 being normal, 0.8 to 1 being ideal for wound healing, and anything less would be not sufficient. Also, taking pulses in the leg is very important. Palpation of the pulses, femorals, popliteals, dorsalis pedis, and posterior tibial arteries in the foot. The femoral arteries and popliteal arteries would be the large vessels in the leg. The dorsalis pedis artery is the pulse that's felt at the dorsum of the foot, and that's responsible for providing blood supply to the toes and to the forefoot, where the posterior tibial artery is responsible for supplying blood to the heel and to the plantar surface of the foot. Now, these arteries are usually collateralized and in the presence of arterial disease may be absent. When an ankle brachial index is received that is performed and the level is higher than what would be expected for what you see on the limb, maybe an extremity that has poor capillary refill or no hair growth on the toes, a toe brachial index would be a more accurate responder in patients who have known calcification or lower extremity artery disease. The ankle brachial index can be falsely elevated in calcified arteries as they're not very compliant when the blood pressure cuff squeezes them down. Here's an example of a patient receiving an ankle brachial index manually. There's also a number of machines that can do this as well. And it can be done rather quickly in the office. Pulse volume recording, or a PVR machine, provides segmental pressures in the leg and is a very important tool in establishing the degree of vascular disease that a patient has. This would use a series of blood pressure cuffs as well as probes that would record a pulse volume. And you would see a readout, as you see on the right, being a triphasic, ideally waveform, less ideal biphasic, and then monophasic or flat. And these, this study would also give you an accurate ankle brachial index as well as toe brachial index. After these tests have been performed, it's very important to get a thorough wound history. Thorough evaluation of the diabetic foot ulcer includes amount of time that the wound is open. Sometimes we'll see these wounds acutely, but very rarely. Oftentimes patients come to us after having a history of having a wound for months and sometimes even years without seeking proper treatment. Size, length, width, depth, and careful attention to undermining and sinus tracts is crucial in taking care of the diabetic foot ulcer. These measurements are integral in understanding if the treatments that we have put in place are having any effect on the diabetic foot ulcer. If we don't see a reduction in area, then we need to be trying other forms of treatments or exploring other options. Examining the exudate, the amount, the color, and the odor is also very important. And the precipitating factors to developing the ulcer, was it traumatic? Could there have been a foreign body that was inserted, or was this just due to blister formation and poor care that resulted in ulceration? Careful attention to the wound bed as well, granular versus fibrotic tissues in the wound. Ideally, we would see granular tissue and robust granular tissue, because pale gray granular tissue or hypergranular or very bright red rubrous granulation tissue would not be good signs as well. And odor can, malodor especially, can be a sign of infection. Peri-wound skin is also very important to evaluate. The presence of callus can cause increased amount of pressure to the area around the ulceration, leading to deterioration of the wound. Erythema can be an early sign of infection, and macerated skin would show that we're not managing the moisture well enough. Using a measuring guide and is important in obtaining accurate measurements. In my center, we take measurements to the millimeter, and every millimeter counts. So especially in the early phases of wound healing, the wound depth on a granular wound is very important in monitoring whether the treatments that we've put in place have been efficacious. The picture to the right shows an undermined wound. These ulcers tend to be more complicated and more difficult to heal. The ideal situation for a wound to heal would to be sloped edges around the circumference of the wound. When you have sinus tracts and undermining, it can cause pseudoclosure of a wound, which would lead to usually abscess formation and then re-ulceration. So careful attention to undermining and to sinus tracts. Many of these ulcers, if the undermining or the sinus tract does not resolve with good wound care and good practices, are typically excised. The wound is made larger in order for the wound to be able to heal. The undermining of the wound causes mixed signals. As granular tissue forms, the granular tissue is meant to come up to the surface of the skin and then have epithelium migrate into the center. And when you have a wound that does not have sloping edges, the body gets confused and can stall healing. The picture on the left shows good, healthy granular tissue that would be noted in a healthy wound. Typically, when you find this granular tissue, this would be a wound that would be well on its way to healing, versus the picture on the right where you have a sloughy, fibrinous coating that is quite dry, and this tissue would need to be removed to accelerate or to promote wound healing. Wound bed preparation is critical in getting an ulcer to heal. A practical tool for the preparation of the wound bed is the time framework. This concept focuses the clinician on optimizing conditions at the wound bed to promote healing. And this tool is best used in the management of chronic ulcers. Chronic ulcers differ from acute wounds like lacerations in that their exudate is different and the tissue characteristics are going to be much different in a chronic ulceration. So time was TIME is an acronym for tissue, infection, moisture, and edge. This was an article that was published in Clinical Practice and Development by Carolyn Dowsett and Heather Newton. And it's a practical tool for the practitioner to use in managing the wound bed and optimizing wound healing. So the T in TIME stands for tissue, and specific characteristics of the tissue play an important role in wound healing. Anytime you have the presence of non-viable, necrotic, or deficient tissue delays wound healing. So this can be as obvious as necrotic eschar that can be thick and black, but it can also be as deficient tissue that would look like granular tissue but would be pale and gray. It, upon debridement, would not have very good blood supply, and this would not be healthy tissue and would need to be excised away or removed to promote wound healing. Early intervention in removing this devitalized tissue will prevent delays to wound healing. And even over time, after the initial removal of the necrotic eschar and non-viable tissue, chronic ulcers will continue to develop slough and adherent non-viable tissue over the base of the wound. And this would be very important to continue removing. This can be removed either surgically or through autolytic debridement. Debridement is the process by which devitalized tissue and foreign material is removed from a wound. The five most common forms of debridement would be surgical, sharp, autolytic, enzymatic, and mechanical. For the most common form of debridement that we use in our center is surgical debridement. Performed by using local anesthetic and in some cases general anesthetic to remove all of the necrotic and non-viable tissue to promote a healthy wound bed. And I'd like to add that debridement would only be performed in a patient who has sufficient blood flow to heal an ulceration. If noted earlier in the assessment that a patient has decreased blood flow and not sufficient blood to heal an ulcer, none of these forms of debridement would be possible until adequate blood flow has been restored. Sharp debridement would be a less common form, but also a way of removing the non-viable or necrotic tissue. Autolytic debridement is the process by which the body removes non-viable tissue, and autolytic debridement can be promoted by keeping a wound moist. There are a number of enzymatic products that help break down fibrin and slough. As another form of debridement, we frequently use collagenase, which is an enzyme that is specific to breaking down fibrin and does not affect the healthy skin around. Mechanical debridement is another form of debridement, and this can be performed by placing, it can be as simple as placing a gauze dressing over top, allowing it to sit in place for a day, and then removing it. Common surgical instruments that would be used for a surgical debridement would be a scalpel, tissue nipper, as well as a bone curette and Irish scissor. We use very frequently bone curettes inside of our wound center. After the necrotic eschar has been placed, the bone curette, which is pictured to the left, is used as a rasp to remove non-viable and soft tissue that's been devitalized. Santol, as I spoke about before, is a collagenase. It is an enzymatic debrider, and it breaks down specifically fibrin and slough. And hydrogel, or wound gel, as you see on the right, can be used to promote moisture balance within the wound, as well as autolytic debridement. The I in time stands for infection. It's important to identify wound infections early, as this can be one of the more common complications in the diabetic foot ulcer. In chronic ulcers, the traditional signs of infection may be more subtle than the obvious signs of infection that we're used to seeing in an acute wound, such as purulent drainage and erythema. Some of these more subtle signs can be as simple as delayed wound healing. An ulcer that does not progress through the stages or does not pass the inflammatory phase into the proliferatory phase could be infected while not showing the frank signs of infection. Also, an increase in exudate, and this does not have to be purulent exudate. It can be just an increase in the amount of serous drainage that is coming out of the wound. Friable granulation tissue, or bright red granular tissue, is also another subtle sign of infection. This bright red granulation tissue, or friable granulation tissue, is noted by either its rubrous appearance or its pale gray appearance. It can be quite soft in nature. The bright red granular tissue tends to bleed very easily, where the friable tissue tends to not. The presence or new undermining to the wound could be a sign of infection as well. Malodor and just a general deterioration of the wound, while other good practice are being in place, could be a sign that the wound is infected, and topical or systemic antimicrobials should be used. Here's an example of bright red granulation tissue. This tissue is hypergranular and can be a sign of infection. This tissue is not healthy tissue and would not support epithelial cell migration. So it should be excised away, and it can be cauterized using silver nitrate or just removed and pressure to achieve hemostasis. It's important to address the underlying issues that might have caused the patient to be at higher risk for infection. Smokers have a higher tendency of developing infections in their ulcers, as well as underlying medical conditions. Patients who are on steroids are also at high risk. are also at high risk for developing wound infections, and the typical signs would not be there. Local therapies such as antimicrobial creams and silver products can be used initially to treat these infections, but if they are unsuccessful, the use of systemic antibiotics for deeper infections when local therapies are not sufficient. They can also be used in conjunction with topical and local antimicrobial therapy. In order to identify the organism that is causing the infection or the predominant organism that's located inside the ulcer, tissue cultures would be ideal, or wound swabs can be used to help identify the prevalent organisms, and this would help us to place the patient on a regimen of systemic antibiotics. Most of the topical antimicrobials cover all bacteria ranging from Pseudomonas to MRSA. Some examples of topical antimicrobials are Acticote, which is an ionized silver dressing, and Bactroban or Mupirocin, which is a broad spectrum antibiotic cream. Ionized silver has been noted in vitro to be effective at killing a multitude of organisms, including MRSA, Pseudomonas, and funguses as well. Aquacel AG is another topical antimicrobial that uses silver in a hydrofiber. This can be used in a wet or dry fashion. And Hydrofera Blue uses methylene blue and ginseng violet as a broad spectrum antimicrobial that can be placed on the surface of the wound to manage localized infections. The M in time stands for moisture, creating and maintaining a moisture balance. And this is key in order to heal a wound. Exudate is produced as part of the body's natural response to tissue damage. And the amount of exudate really depends on pressure gradients within the tissue. These pressure gradients can change depending on whether the tissue is infected or inflamed. Also, edema to the surrounding tissue of the wound can affect how much exudate a wound will have. And sufficient moisture in a wound promotes autolytic debridement and will also act as a transport medium for growth factors to circulate throughout the wound. Having a wound that is too dry will trap all of the growth factors in one place and will not allow the body to use its process of autolytic debridement to keep the wound healed. Usually you'll see scab formation quickly in a dry wound bed, and promoting moisture balance is very important. There are different types of exudate that are going to be coming out of a wound. Most commonly it would be serous or a clear yellow drainage. Sometimes a purulent drainage would be found, or a hemopurulent, which would be brown or almost a very deep brown, which would be a combination of blood and pus. And hemorrhagic is what we would see in an ulcer that has been recently traumatized. It's going to be red in color. The selection of dressing is very important in maintaining moisture balance. And the dressing that you select should be used in order to manage the amount of exudate that is coming out of a wound. Heavily exudating wounds benefit from absorptive dressings such as calcium alginate or dry hydrofibers like Aquacel. In wounds that are heavily exudating and can't be managed with dressings such as calcium alginate, negative pressure wound therapy can be applied. This would be using an occlusive dressing with a set of suction to pull the moisture away from the wound bed. Wound exudate can also be very damaging or irritating to the wound, and in and of itself can cause wound deterioration. Dry wound beds, with the exception of stable dry gangrene in the patient with a vascular disease, should promote moisture within the wound. So using hydrogels to add moisture into the wound to promote a moisture balance, and occlusive dressings over top to not allow that moisture to evaporate. Moistened hydrofibers as well can be used to add moisture to the wound bed, and Vaseline gauze or different ointments over top can help seal that moisture into the wound bed to promote the appropriate moisture balance. To the left is an example of a hydrocolloid called Duoderm. This is an occlusive dressing, and that on its own, on a dry wound bed, will promote moisture within and will promote an autolytic debridement. In drier wounds, a moistened hydrofiber, like what you see on the right, with an occlusive dressing over top to keep the moisture in place, will promote autolytic debridement as well as promoting moisture balance to allow growth factors to circulate around the wound. The E in time stands for edge. In order to promote epithelialization or epithelial cell migration of the wound bed, it's important to pay careful attention to the wound edges. Particularly in the patient with diabetic neuropathy, calluses can develop around the peri-wound, which are an overproduction of hyperkeratotic tissue as a result of a neuropathic foot. And the presence of undermining or sinus tracts may also be concealed within the wound edge, and it's important to address these undermining or sinus tracts as it will delay in the migration of epithelial cells into the granular wound bed. In particular, when dealing with the diabetic foot ulcer, the gold standard for treating the plantar surface ulcer is placing the patient in a total contact cast. Okay, I'm gonna hurry up. A total contact cast is placed over the foot and the lower extremity in order to distribute pressure evenly over the bottom of the foot. And this is ideal. Most patients who have optimal blood flow can heal a plantar surface ulcer with a total contact cast on average in about 5 weeks. Now, although not as effective, 3D walkers and custom-made insoles can also offload an ulcer and promote healing, but it's not as effective as the total contact cast. And other devices such as AFOs or an ankle-foot orthotic can be important in treating patients who have foot drop. Foot drop can accelerate the rate at which the foot strikes the ground and leave patients at high risk for developing ulcers as well as delaying healing. Here's an example to the left of a total contact cast. It is placed over the whole foot and lower leg, and this can be to treat a quite small ulcer that's on the plantar surface. It offloads all the pressure evenly. There's a 3D walker to the right. This is less ideal for offloading a foot ulcer, but can be effective as well. To the left, you'll see an AFO or an ankle foot orthotic, and this will prevent foot drop or decelerate the rate at which a foot strikes the ground. And to the right is a crow walker, and this would be specific to patients who have foot deformities. And this would be used not only during the treatment of the wound, but in order to prevent the reoccurrence of future ulcers. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy has also been shown in randomized clinical trials to decrease the number of amputations. Patients who are candidates for hyperbaric oxygen therapy would typically go through anywhere between 5 and 7 treatments a week of about 2 hours. They're placed in a high-pressure, oxygen-rich environment to promote wound healing. Advanced modalities have also been shown. There's actually very few technologies that have been proven effective in prospective randomized trials to treat the diabetic foot ulcer. Regranix, which is platelet-derived growth factor, is one, as well as apligraf, which is a bilayered skin substitute, and dermagraft, which is human fibroblast dermal substitute. And these can be put in place over the ulcer after all other treatments have been tried and failed. This is an example of an apligraf. It comes on an auger. It is actual living tissue that does not come from the patient. It's an allogenic skin substitute that would be placed over the wound bed to accelerate wound healing. There would be intercommunication between the granular cells in the wound bed and the living cells that are in the skin substitute that promote wound healing. Dermagraft is another skin substitute that can be used and applied in a similar fashion. And Regranix, or platelet-derived growth factor, is actually the first product that had actual evidence that it healed wounds faster, and it is indicated solely for the treatment of diabetic foot ulcers. Although amputation is what we strive to avoid in our patients who have diabetic foot ulcers, we know that 15% of ulcers are going to end in amputation. And this has an increased cost to healthcare throughout the course of the patient's life. Although five-year mortality rates after an amputation exceed 50%, studies do show that quality of life markers are higher in patients that are post-amputation versus living with chronic ulcers. Some patients can try to manage and treat diabetic foot ulcers for a number of months or years and make zero progress, and that can be very damaging to the psyche of the patient. And amputation should be considered after all other therapies have failed or have been exhausted, or when a diabetic foot ulcer advances to a wet gangrene where it can compromise the patient's life. These are a couple of the sources that I used to put this presentation together. I want to thank you all for listening. If there's time, I would love to take some questions. 4 minutes, very good.
Thank you, Dr. Salinero. Maybe my question is too obvious, but could you give your opinion on the idea of adding a dental expert to a diabetic foot team in order to contribute from the oral cavity and improving inflammation in the mouth to these complications?
If I heard you correctly, I think the question was having a healthcare team to manage a foot ulcer to prevent complications. Is that correct?
Yes, and the role someone could play with regards the inflammation of the gingiva. As I try to explain this relationship between gingival inflammation and systemic complications of diabetes.
Certainly, in my wound center, we have a team of a healthcare team that treats the patients who come through our doors, consisting of not only surgeons and surgeons of different specialties, vascular surgery, podiatry, and plastic surgery, as well as trained and certified wound care nurses, as well as nutritionists. In the comprehensive care and treatment of the diabetic foot ulcer. And we found that we get better results when the ulcer is treated by a team of a multitude of specialties. I couldn't hear the second part of the question.
Well, the second part of my question was if it would be useful to not for the treatment of the ulcer as such, but in the prevention of increasing burden of this type of lesions. Could there be a role played by a dental professional?
By what, I'm sorry? Dental, thank you.
A dental profession.
I would have to say that we do a dental screening, but it's very limited, and it's usually just in relation to how patients who have limited teeth or no teeth really have trouble getting the proper nutrition to heal ulcers. I am not aware of any links directly between gingival disease or mouth disease and ulceration, but certainly in the diabetic patient, they have a much higher prevalence of both periodontal disease as well as developing foot ulcerations. Thank you.
Just to piggyback on what the professor was saying, what he was alluding to is the fact that when a patient has gum disease, they are producing significant concentrations of inflammatory mediators and cytokines. That's getting to these wounds. And therefore, we don't have to be a genius to figure out that it's going to make matters worse. So what we are suggesting is that a part of your team should be a dental professional who helps to control these patients' periodontal disease, since with periodontal disease, these inflammatory mediators and cytokines would only make these wounds worse.
Certainly having an increased level in inflammatory markers inside the body is going to delay, if not prevent, wound healing altogether. It's certainly not something that we have considered in the past, but it's something that I would like to explore moving forward.
We'd like to thank our presenter this morning, Michael Salinero, for such an excellent presentation.
Thank you very much. Thank you all.
It would almost appear it could go on for many more hours. We want to thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me.
And for having you here in Jamaica at this 19th annual symposium, the UDOP.